So welcome to the 4th Annual Data Science Symposium.
I'm really excited to talk about data, making the invisible visible.
This is what I'm trying to teach you today, is there's a secret to all of this.
That's your data scientist. In the data science community, they're often referred to as unicorns.
So we're going to create an internet of water, which is a network of producers, data hubs, and data users.
Cyanobacteria are, you know, it's an organism that's existed for a long, long time.
It's always thrilling to talk about things that could kill you. And one of the reasons we care about these cyanobacteria are because they can produce these cyanotoxin molecules, which are harmful to humans and other animals.
Recreational waterborne illness remains a significant health problem, actually, in the United States. Rivers and creeks, especially in urban areas.
Where water used to spread and slow, it now, whether it's on the roof of this building or the impermeable street outside or any orchard or any farm field, parking lot at Safeway, the bypass itself, right? All engineered to drain as rapidly as possible. That is where we're starting to get into this idea of what is a puddle.
We're trying to put functionality back into our river systems and create multiple benefits. How best can we go about doing that? And one of the premises behind the approach that we're taking is this idea of restoring seasonality to a lot of our flow regimes in the best that we can.
And so with the berm closed, nutrient inputs from industrial, agricultural, and residential runoff collect inside the slough, and this is conducive to algal growth.
We've been studying a multi-benefit alternative called the horizontal levee. These systems are used to polish wastewater that's fed through their subsurface while restoring wetland habitat and also protecting levees.
And so climate change is driving the frequency of these harmful algal bloom events. And so this points to a need to be able to use sensors, so developing new sound technologies and new platforms, to go out and do rapid environmental assessments. And this is where sort of I start tying in the engineering with the science.
And now we have supercomputers, we have a whole constellation of satellites, we're fusing together European satellites with American satellites, and it's really an exciting time.
Fortunately, trash is sort of a unique pollutant. We can see it lying around on the ground there. That's great, and our machines can see it as well.
There are a number of places where you can't traipse, you can't kind of walk across a wetland, but you can fly with the right permits. You can fly across a wetland. And so we found that what looked to be, you know, pristine from the land view, you know, looking out over this is Corte Madera Marsh, it turns out, you know, you could spot quite a bit of trash just kind of nestled among the vegetation.
One big theme that I want to keep in mind here, and I mentioned this sort of remote sensing revolution that's going on right now, is that we're finding that a lot of people are merging different data sets, bringing UAV and aerial imagery together with planet or, you know, ground measurements and other imagery from different satellites together. That's a really big theme here.
But of course, water resources management decisions are not always conducted at that scale. It's conducted at a much more localized, regional level. And so many of these decisions rely upon ground-based observations, modeling to help inform decision-making at those scales. And so the question is, how do we combine these data sets and leverage the in situ networks and also leverage the remote sensing to build an enhanced water quality monitoring program?